My generation and future generations, they're all going to be impacted by this. The earth is not going to support us anymore if it keeps going how it is.
I'd be in school right now if something else was being done.
They are speaking up and walking out because they feel like the rest of the world isn't doing enough. Thanks for being with us. I'm Dan Haggerty.
And I'm Kathy Marshall. Worldwide, millions of students took part in today's climate strike. Here in Portland, students all across the area left class to rally downtown, then march across the Hawthorne Bridge to gather at OMSI.
So we have team coverage for you on today's strike. Morgan Romero kicking things off for us downtown. Morgan, we saw a huge crowd down there.
Yeah, Kathy and Dan, it was incredible and it was inspiring, honestly, to say the least, to be embedded with them marching across the bridge. They were articulate, they knew what they were talking about, and they felt like this issue really, really impacted them. At last check with organizers, they told me there were 20,000 people in attendance at the rally today. However, Portland police would not confirm that number to us. Of course, people of all ages, young and old. We do know thousands of students walked out of class to send a message to people in power, telling them the planet is warming and they need to do something. A new generation of young activists peacefully took to the streets of Portland to show their frustration with the lack of action.
There is a united front of people, as you can see in Portland, as you can see across the world today, which know and believe that climate change is real and that it's directly affecting our right to a future.
And I think it's sending a message to politicians that these are eventually going to be the people who vote, and if you don't listen to what we're saying, you're not going to stay in power.
A number of downtown streets were shut down Friday morning as ralliers started at Terry Shrunk Plaza and marched across the Hawthorne Bridge to OMSI, where a climate justice festival was going on.
My generation and future generations, they're all going to be impacted by this. And eventually the earth is not going to support us anymore if it keeps going how it is.
They held up powerful signs saying things like, our planet is dying, choose eco, not ego. And if you were smarter, we would be in school.
Climate change is the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. Because people acted although it wasn't real for a long time.
Laws need to be passed and people need to start doing something more than is happening right now. And I'd be in school right now if something else was being done.
They're sending a global warning by stepping up and saying, we're gonna make a difference to save our future.
It's important to have youth voices heard in the matter, and it's so nice to see such a big turnout. There's so many people here today and it just makes me feel proud.
Young organizers are calling on local officials to pass legislation and advance clean energy policies. They're calling on world leaders to do more.
When you're saying, I'm not going to stand or sit in a classroom just learning things when my future is at stake. I'm going to disrupt what is considered usual for one day.
There's a lot of social justice issues that are out there, and climate change is so prevalent because it is directly affecting our future. Having an event like this, it brings awareness and it has more people care.
Overall, police say it was peaceful, but they did arrest three people. Police used pepper spray after a man vandalized the Hawthorne Bridge and fought officers. They say they found weapons in his backpack. And two 17-year-olds were arrested for disorderly conduct and interfering with a police officer. And by the way, Portland Public Schools sent letters home to parents of middle and high schoolers telling them their absence would be excused if they prearranged it with their teachers. The district did tell parents, though, they could not ensure student safety once they left class. Back to you.
Morgan, thank you. Well, today's walkout was organized mostly by teenagers. Some kids were there who just started early elementary school. KGW's Joe Ranieri joins us in studio. And Joe, some families who are at today's walkout are already making some changes around the house.
Absolutely right, Kathy. Now, some of these younger kids I spoke to won't even be able to drive a car for another 10 years, but even elementary kids are realizing the importance about getting the word about climate change. And some have already been challenging their families to do a little bit better.
Our global climate impacts everyone, young and old. Many parents who marched in Friday's global climate strike walkout wanted to make sure their kids know how important it is to make changes now.
A few thousand.
One of the youngest among the thousands was 6-year-old Huck Ungier, who's a first grader at Abernathy Elementary School.
It's really fun and it helps protect the environment.
At his house, it's more than just recycling to protect the climate.
We don't really take cars. We mostly ride our scooters, bikes, and we play outside a lot.
Many parents have been sharing with their kids about being more sustainable.
We have chickens. We have a large garden. I do a lot of canning. We cook from scratch. And we tried to eliminate plastic in our home, coming in through food packaging.
Some of the youngest kids at Friday's rally brought it upon themselves to test their own families on trying to eliminate items we're all so familiar with.
My mom showed us a video of what's going to happen.
I showed him a video of Greta Thunberg and how passionate she was, and he was trying to think what he could do.
So led by Elias, the Souls try to do away with plastic for an entire week. So
he challenged us last week to go 1 week without buying any plastic, not even at the grocery store, not even that little turn top at the top of the milk container, which proved very difficult.
And how'd it go?
We did it.
The Souls say it's those small changes that we all can start doing to make a difference.
And Melissa, that mom you just heard from, did confess to me. She didn't completely go all week without buying plastic. She bought a rotisserie chicken and the packaging had some plastic. But all in all, buying one thing with plastic for a week, not all that bad. It's not easy to do. If you think about
it, very hard to do. Yeah.
Exactly. It's a challenge, but they seem to be doing it. It's something that she wants to encourage other families to try doing as well.
And the kids are now watching.
Exactly right. Once the kids are on board, okay, we got to do it.
Yeah.
All right. Appreciate it, Joe. Thank you. So if you were down there today, if you weren't, if you just want to check out a little bit more of it, we have a lot of stuff for you online. There are slideshows on our website, some raw video, basically just when we hit record, everything that we see that doesn't make air, you can take a look at that, and different perspectives from today's climate strike. Then at 6:30, we're going to take a step back, look a little wider at this whole situation, because of course people were doing this around the world. We'll check in with some of those other events. We have new information for you tonight about prominent political fundraiser Terry Bean. Today he dropped his $2 million lawsuit against a prosecutor and detective working on his criminal case. Bean is a real estate developer and Democratic political fundraiser in Portland. He's accused of sexually abusing a 15-year-old boy in 2015. The trial in that case is scheduled for later this year. Last week, though, Bean had filed a lawsuit that claimed a police detective and the Lane County DA colluded with the alleged victim's attorney. But today, Bean withdrew that suit. In a memo filed today, Bean's lawyer says he stands behind what was in the complaint, but will instead focus on his criminal trial, which starts in November.
High school football games on a Friday night kicking off in just about an hour. Oh, yeah. One reason to watch the forecast and a lot of others for the weekend.
Well, I think they're getting lucky tonight, Matt. What do you think?
Always, yeah. This is exactly what you want to see on a Friday night. The sun coming out, especially after a drizzly, damp, and misty morning. But that is a thing of the past. It's 70 degrees right now. We've warmed up a little bit. That's out in Washington County at the Reserve. Here's the Dalles. You can see Mountain Hood looking west from our camera on the Oregon Veterans Home. 70 degrees there as well. And over at the Oregon coast, we're even getting some sunshine going on there. It looks good. 65 degrees. So you can see the clear weather here. That's tomorrow. That weather system, though, that brings the weather back on Sunday. That brings the rain back on Sunday. But tomorrow morning, just fog. Then a really nice Saturday, warm into the 70s. Rain Sunday, but much of next week looks dry. We'll have more on that later. Back to you.
All right, Matt, we'll talk to you again soon. We got some other quick stories for you here. Police arresting a 16-year-old accused of threatening to carry out a school shooting at Sandy High School. The teen posted this threat on the app TikTok. They are charged right now with disorderly conduct, but investigators say they actually didn't have any access to weapons. They don't believe that the threat was credible.
Surveillance cameras caught thieves slamming into a Tacoma pot shop early Thursday morning. The suspects grabbed as much product as they could, but didn't even touch the cash register. The store owner says she can't believe someone went to extremes for a few hundred dollars worth of marijuana. The suspects took off before police arrived.
We want to talk to Blue Line riders from Gresham. You should get ready for some delays starting on Sunday and running for about 2 weeks. TriMet will be shutting down stops between Ruby Junction and Cleveland Avenue for improvements there. So instead, shuttle buses are going to be servicing that stretch. Drivers will also see road closures at several intersections, including Eastman Parkway. We have some more details for you online.
The city of Portland made a big change when it remodeled its marquee building downtown.
We're talking about changes in the bathroom. They've banned urinals. They're gone. KGW's Pat Doris learned more about this today. Pat?
Right. Well, this is this Portland building that we're talking about. The city will have dozens of bathroom stalls that either gender can use there, and they suggest that no urinals allows them to be flexible for the future.
Urinals are the things men often use to relieve themselves in the bathroom. They come in lots of sizes and shapes, and you can find one in just about any men's restroom. But not in the Portland building, not when it reopens. The city has redesigned all the bathrooms to be gender neutral, which means urinals are banned even in the men's room. Conservative talk show host Lars Larson first told me about the change. He is outraged.
I think it's ridiculous. First of all, I know that it already makes a lot of people uncomfortable. All right. Secondly, it's going to take up a lot more space. And third, anyone who's ever been to any public event, have you seen the line at the ladies' room? Do you see any line at the men's room?
He's not alone in that opinion.
I think it's kind of ridiculous. After all, what are they going to do? Go make everything just one thing?
Actually, yes. The building's first, third, and 15th floors will have large multi-stall bathrooms that men and women will use together. Other floors will have separate men's and women's bathrooms. But every floor will also have at least one any gender bathroom. Gender and bathroom use has been a big deal when it comes to those who are transgender or gender fluid. But the city made no mention of that in an email to employees. The chief administrative officer wrote that the gender-neutral bathrooms are, quote, the right way to ensure success as your employer and remove arbitrary barriers in our community. And some I met on the street today agree.
It's Portland, so something new, something different. Makes sense.
Well, this topic has sparked quite a debate on my KGW Facebook page. Jason writes in, regardless of any social sensitivity, gender-neutral bathrooms are just a better design and more convenient. On the other hand, David writes, this has disaster written all over it. Sorry. I'd love to see what you think. Go to my Pat Doris KGW Facebook page and weigh in.
I'm surprised that Facebook page hasn't crashed yet today, yeah. Pat. People weighing in on that. You know, it's going to be an interesting study. Let's see what happens, right?
Yep.
Meanwhile, Pat's story does bring us to tonight's poll. Should all restrooms be gender neutral? We want to know what you think about this. Go to kgw.com/vote to weigh in or pull out your phone. Go to the app and look for the vote tile on there. Tell us what you think.
Coming up, social media companies make moves to take certain celebrity-endorsed weight loss products off their platforms. The change is coming to Instagram and Facebook.
And from tea to coffee, the Northwest Company bringing new meaning to the phrase, hot cup of Joe.
That he is.